Don't you know that sometimes
You're some kind of wonderful. Some kind of wonderful. Yes, he is. Some kind of wonderful.
So it's been our prayer to go out and do a Christian outreach, and this is just an answer to a prayer that we had a long time ago, and it's come to pass right here tonight. It's our first one. My wife, Michelle Shepherd, here, and she's going to tell you a little bit about a Nigerian praise song.
Yeah, the next one we're going to do is a Nigerian praise song. You might have heard it on the radio. How many have ever taken participation in the March for Jesus's that they have? Tell you all about that. It's going to be this Saturday down at 5th Street in Virginia in Reno. We're going to do the march again. We start at 10 o'clock on Saturday morning. All of you, please come out. We're going to have a wonderful time. There's probably going to be 5,000 people there. And we're going to end up in Dick Taylor Park to have a praise celebration with all different bands and puppet shows. And the youth are going to come up and do some dances and all kinds of fun stuff. So I want to make sure and tell you all about that so you'll be there with us. And the next song we're going to do is a Nigerian praise song called Oshe Baba. Whoops, sorry about that, you guys.
To teach my people how to praise the Lord.
You know, all the way back when music was created, you know, God created that music. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
And all the way back from centuries ago to over 2,000 years ago, amen, Christ had to die on his son for the cross for us to get to heaven. Amen. And even back then, I think back then, the Christian faith was even more strong. There was Bach, there was Beethoven that did all these things, all these songs for the Lord. They were all God-inspired. We're going to do an instrumental right here and feature Miss Michelle Shepherd on the violin over there. Give her a little hand there. How he talks to you and how he answers prayers and how he gives you lyrics, how he gives you the desires of your heart. The Bible says he'll give you the desires of your heart. You just take that step towards him. And my desire has always been music. And this is an original, like she said, and it's called In Your Shadow. our protector, our guide, out of Psalms 91.
My protector, my guide.
Thank you. Amen. It's funny how you look back at things. You say prayers, you know. And I was praying a short verse on that song one night, and I laid in bed, and I said, oh, God. I was praying. I was just thinking, trying to read, and I said, well, it's time to go to sleep, you know. So I rolled over. I was reading my Bible. I shut out the light. I started to go to sleep, and then God said to me, he said, Father God, these lyrics came to me and said, Father God, must have been Holy Spirit, because he said, Father God, you are the door. Christ your Son, he is the key. And your Spirit, I long for more. All I need is three to see. Speaking of the Trinity, and I said, man. And the more I thought about that, I said, man, that was God, because it didn't come out Jesus and then the Father and then the Holy Ghost. It didn't come out Holy Ghost, Father, then Jesus. But it came out in the line, Father, Son, Holy Ghost. I said, man, that was God, because it came like this. Just verbatim, but anyway, we're gonna let him play the fiddle again. Do you want to hear the fiddle?
Yeah.
I said, how many people out in Truckee like the fiddle? Let me hear you. Soul steal. He was in a bind, says way behind this, looking to make a deal. When he came across this showgirl, saw him fiddling, playing it hot. Then the devil jumped up on it. Hickory Stone said, girl, let me tell you what. I guess you didn't know it, but I'm a fiddle player too. And if you care to take it there, I'll make a bet with you. Now you play pretty good fiddle, girl, but give the devil his due. I bet a fiddle of gold gets your soul, so I think I'm better than you. And I'll take your bet, you're gonna regret, 'cause I'm the best that's ever been. Body buzzing up your boat, playing a fiddle hard. This is the music drummer and the devil knows I'm God. And you and you'll get this shot, you'll be a pro. If you lose, it'll get your soul. Said, I'll start the show. And fire flew from his fingertips as he rolled up his bow. When he pulled the bow across the strings, it made an evil hiss. And a man of demons joined in and it sounded something like this. But sit down in that chair right there and let me show you how it's done. Son of a gun, confess it's ever been. Come on. Bye, bye, bye. You got a victory over the devil here tonight. How many know? Let me hear you out there. Amen. For the Bible says, through Christ, we can do all things.
Amen.
That strengthens us. Amen. Amen. Yeah. We're going to stretch and do another instrumental for you. It goes like this.
Thank you.
like I said, it's been an answer to prayer coming out here and playing for you in Truckee here. And I just want to tell you that a little testimony, which when I was a little boy, my mother, can we dim the lights a little bit? I'm like, man, that's brighter than the sun. Yeah, that's good. Hey, when I was a boy, my mother went through 6 divorces, and she was on the road all the time as an entertainer and what have you, and no one ever was able to share the gospel with me. So I fill in. My oldest brother was a drummer. My middle brother was a guitar player. And I fell into that musician drug thing, you know, and lived my life. I started dealing drugs. I was living off dealing drugs for almost 3 years. And I would just like take weeks off and go out. We lived in Vegas. I'd go out to Lake Mead out there. And you know, I was just going through all this stuff. And my oldest brother died in a car accident. He was driving home drunk one night, and the van flipped numerous times. They don't even know how many times. It was just smashed up. His head, they said, took an impact the as hard as you would take a baseball bat in full swing and just go, bam. He's in coma for a week. He died, went in Sunday and died the following Sunday. And about that time, I started getting called to the gospel. God was just calling me. No one really shared it with me. You know, I didn't have the fortune of having a dad as a pastor or being raised in a church or what have you, you know, and God was calling me, so I tried to read the scriptures in the midst of everything else I was doing. And one night I just broke down. I said, man, I opened up the Bible, and I was stoned. I opened up the Bible, and I started trying to read it, and I couldn't understand a word of it. I was like, man, I said, God, I was crying out with all my heart, I said, God, come in and fill my life. God, just help me read this. Help me to understand this. And before you know it, it was like something hit me from the tip of my head, and my whole body was shaking like this. It was unlike any other drug that I've ever experienced in my life, which I probably experienced them all, except for shooting up heroin. Thank God for that. My big brother told me if I ever did that, he would kill me and put me out of my misery, because he's seen people that had went through it. You know. At any rate, I believe I got saved that night. And in I guess you would call them the people that buy off the buyers. They would come to my door and I'd say, no, you know, I said, you know, I'm into the Lord now, you know, and they'd go, yeah, right, they would laugh at me, and they would shut the door, like a week would went by, and I still had what us older people know as roaches. I still had roaches up in my closet, and they were calling me. That was the last thing I had. I got rid of everything, you know, and that was the last thing I had was these pot. It's marijuana you probably all know. It's pot that went down to this big, and under roaches, and you put them up in your closet, blah blah blah. And they were calling me for a week. This pot was calling me for a week, and I fell. I went and I smoked this pot. I smoked those roaches. I'd gotten rid of everything but that, and the devil got me like that, man. And I can't explain this feeling. All I can tell you is that I was saved for a week. I didn't have a church home, and I smoked that pot, and all of a sudden it was like, this is exactly how it felt. If you were to put me in a room and shut out all the lights, and there was no sun, there was no moon, there was no nothing, I'm talking pitch black. That's exactly the feeling that I felt. And I was like, man, I blew it with God. I blew it with God. And so I went out back in my bands. I got married. That didn't go so well. She was hooked on crank. I was on pot. We were both dealing drugs. She was hooked on crank. I was hooked on addicted to marijuana, mostly, was my big thing. People say you can't be, don't believe. That's a lie from the pit of hell. You can't be hooked on pot. So I fell back into it. My wife, I came home one night from playing the Las Vegas Troubadour, and my wife pulled a shotgun on me. And she was ready to blow my head off. You've been cheating on me, I just know it. See, because when you do these drugs, man, it does a number on your mind. It does a number on your mind. And it makes you snap like that. You just pop. and you'll just like snap. You'll shoot somebody, man. I'm serious. And I said, man, I got to get out of here. I said, God, I knew you once, man. I said, Lord, you got to get me out of here. I said, you got to get me out of this. Here my wife is pointing a shotgun at me, and I had two children, and they're running around screaming, ah! And I'm going, oh my God. So a week later, God answered my prayer. Boom. We were playing our first tour in Hawaii for 6 months. We were over there. And I realized that I knew God answered that prayer. But I went out on the road in a rock band. We traveled for 9 years on the road, solid. 9 years. We started opening up. We opened up for Heart. We opened up for King Cobra, Edgar Winter. We were just about there, just about signed. For the young people probably don't know those bands, but that's cool. To make a long story short, they were pretty national act. They were like Pearl Jam would be right now, especially Heart was. And I fell back into the sin, man, smoking dope every night, you know, messing with the women, the whole scene. 9 years this went on. But in the middle of that 9 years, God called me in my room again. He said, Vance, it's time to quit. This was about 4 years into it, or 5 years into it. We were just getting ready to cut an album. And God said, you got to quit. Because I knew I wasn't strong enough. I didn't have any fellowship. I didn't know the Word of God. I didn't know anything. And so I went to the band. I said, I got to quit, man. I said, I can't do it. I said, the temptation is too much for me, man. And they all laughed at me. Oh, yeah, Jesus freak. You. So they talked me into staying. They go, man, you can't leave now, man. We're doing an album, blah, blah, blah. We're doing an album, blah, blah, blah. I said, okay, so I stayed. Well, that sucked me into another 5 years of my life. And so being beat up by the road, I had another kid in Reno. And that's what brought me to Reno, came to Reno for my girlfriend that just had a kid. And in the midst of this, I was in work. I got a part-time music job in the music store, Star Sound in Reno, and Terrell Taylor and Michael Wynn, I don't know if you know him, at Greater Light Christian Center, came in. And they were singing praise songs, and they said, man, I came in, I go, man, you guys are Christians, huh? And they go, yeah. And I said, praise God, I am too. They said, praise God, they need some light in here. So he invited me out. I went to the church, and to make a long story short, I started really getting fed the Word of God. And you know what I learned? You can't blow it with God. God loves you so much that he gave his only begotten Son, and if you slip and fall, need to get up and ask for repentance. If you leave here tonight and you die in a car accident, God forbid, you're going to go down there. You need to repent, and you need to tonight. Tonight, I got to tell you that the only unforgivable sin is blasphemy of the Holy Ghost, is when you come in and you deny everything you've learned. You've been a Christian. You come in, you say, that's not real. That's not God. God's not real. And you know the truth. And that's a pretty heavy-duty sin. If you know God, you know how he worked in your life. You're probably never his to begin with. That's a pretty heavy-duty thing, man. But I'm here to tell you tonight, and our whole purpose of coming here, it's been a prayer for my wife and I, for God to open the doors to come do ministry like this in the churches on our weeks off. And we took this 2 weeks off because of the March for Jesus meeting, and Jim happened to have an open spot, and I praise God for bringing us here tonight. Is there any keyboard players in the house tonight? Our young lady, where is she, Jim?
Sandy.
Raise the high.
Michelle's got a little something she wants to share with you. Yeah. Michelle wants to share something with you.
I think what I'll do is kind of sit down on your level. How about that? That way I don't feel like I'm so high up here. I'm glad that we got to do this concert tonight. Like my husband Van says, this has been an answer to a prayer for us to be able to come out here and play music for believers and unbelievers as well. Vance and I, our job is playing music in casinos. I'm sure a lot of you have been in casinos, you adults, and see the bands that are in there. We're very blessed to be able to do that. We're blessed that the Lord has allowed us to be there, and that the Lord has trusted us to be strong enough to be in those places. There's been many times that we've been able to be in the casinos, and we've been able to talk to somebody who's really lost or really doesn't know which way to go, and give them a little bit more direction and let them know who we are and let them know that we're Christians and what we believe in. And God has done some pretty amazing things through that. And I came to the Lord about, it's been about almost 4 years ago. I was quite into the world. I'm 25 right now, so I met Vance when I was 20. I wasn't even 21 yet, and we started dating. I was pretty lost. I had a pretty mixed up childhood, especially my teenage years. My mother was not in the best of professions. She did a lot of things that really go against God, and I was kind of brought up in that atmosphere. So when I hit teenagehood, I had a lot of problems discerning what was right and what was wrong. My mom, I love her to death. She's the most wonderful woman in the world, but she doesn't know the Lord. And so she doesn't have that in her to really know what is right and what is wrong and what does the Lord want you to do in certain situations. And she would tell me, you know, Michelle, you need to find a guy, you need to have sex, I'll put you on the pill, you know, all this kind of stuff. And my mom was telling me that, so you can imagine, I thought, wow, you know, I guess it must be right if, you know, I mean, my mom's wanting me to do all this. So when I was 14 years old, I went to a party with one of my girlfriends. We were invited, and we knew there was going to be alcohol there. Didn't know there'd be drugs there, but I went there, and I was drugged. I had some PCP put in my alcohol. It knocked me out, and I was raped by 4 guys at once. Usually I don't cry when I talk about it anymore, but that was a really, I was 14 when that happened, and that like really messed with my head as I was growing up as a teenager. I didn't really have my dad in the picture. My dad's an alcoholic and a drug user, and he's really, really far out there. He comes back to the Lord every once in a while. He knows the Lord, but he's really walking in the wrong ways. And so I didn't really have a man figure in my life when this happened to me. And I would reach out to men for love, and I thought that they would help fulfill that void inside of me from when I was raped and my self-esteem went really low. So I lived like this. I got married when I was 19 to a man that I had dated for quite a few years. He was very, very, very abusive. Very abusive. If I was still with him right now, I would be dead. I wouldn't be with him. I would be 6 feet under. I was with him for quite a few years. We got married, and I had to basically leave about a month and a half after we were married because the beatings were so bad. And I got involved with another guy that was the same situation. He was very abusive. I kept going through this cycle of relationships with men that had this jealousy problem. They were very possessive, and they liked to hit. Thank you. He's such a good husband. And then finally I met Vance, and I was going through my divorce with my husband at this time, and it took about a year to get through. I met Vance. He was working at Star Sound, like he told you. He was working at the music store, and right away we hit it off. We were both, I guess you could say, we somewhat knew about Christianity, didn't know too much. We were very straight away from it. We started dating. We dated for about 2.5 years. We were in the world, basically living together. We weren't living together, but we had that kind of a relationship. Definitely not God's plan. And Vance, when Michael went in, Terrell Taylor from Greater Light Christian Center came into Star Sound when he was talking to you about that, he got an urging in his heart to go to church. He said, you know, I think I really need to go to church. I think that's what I need to do. And I said, well, you know, that's great. And so he started going to Greater Light, and about 2 weeks after he went, I decided that I wanted to go with him. And so we started going to church together, and our relationship completely changed. We were convicted by the sin of being together and not being married. We were convicted by that, knew that it was wrong. And we knew that if we were going to continue walking with God, that we had to stop doing what we were doing. So here we go from a relationship, a total worldly relationship, to a relationship that we had to walk backwards in. And Vance and I slowly, over a period of about 2 years, walked backward in our relationship, stopped having the premarital sex, and in turn became best friends, just like brother and sister. And him and I are best friends. I couldn't ever ask for a better friend than him. And God blessed us, and God let us grow together. And we grew at the same speed. I mean, everything that we grew in the Lord, we grew in together. And it was just like the next step.